But I'm picking up in verse 22, and straightway Jesus constrained his disciples to get into his ship and to go before him to the other side while he sent the multitudes away. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into a mountain apart to pray. And when the evening was come, he was there alone. The multitude was gone. The disciples were in a boat. But the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them walking on the sea. Now let me stop there and say, a man called me in and debated me one day and said, "Preacher, Jesus really didn't walk on the water. They had taken an old dock and had cut the dock off even with the water, and the poles were up even with the water, and he was walking on them poles." Now let me tell you something, honey. Look up here. I smoked a lot of dope before I met Jesus, but I've never been that dumb. I've never been that dumb to believe Jesus. If the Bible said he walked on the water, you mark her down, Jesus walked on the water. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, it's a spirit. That's what you get for watching spooky movies all the time. And they cried out for fear. And straightway Jesus spake unto them, saying, "Be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid." And Peter answered and said unto him, "Lord, if it be thou, then I want you to do something. Bid me to come unto thee on the water." And he said, "Come." And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water. Here's why: to go to Jesus. And when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried, saying, "Lord, save me." And immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand, caught him, and said unto him, "O thou little faith, why didst thou doubt?" And when they were come into the ship, the wind ceased. Then they that were in the ship came and worshipped him, saying, "Of the truth, here's one thing we know, thou art the Son of God." The whole concept of this chapter is amazing to me, because it pivots around one hunger that one disciple out of 12 had. And that was in verse number 29, Peter wanted to get closer to Jesus. Did you know, Brother Charles, that's a good thing for people to want to get close to Jesus. And preaching ought to motivate you to want to get closer to Jesus. I wouldn't sit under a pastor that his preaching didn't compel me to want to be more for God. Now let me say this. There's three kinds of preachers, and you're going to sit under one of those three if you're going to go to a church. First of all, you got pamper preachers. All they do is go around burping and patting everybody, trying to keep everybody happy. And instead of becoming fishers of men, they're content to be keepers of the aquarium. Well, I got news. If you want a pamper preacher, you are at the wrong church today, honey. I'm not burping you every time some little something don't fit your fancy, and I'm not chasing you all over the country to listen to your nonsense. I call those pamper preachers. Some of you already looking pale. Cheer up. This thing's going to get a whole lot worse. Then, number two, you got your performance preachers. They're nothing more than a cheap sideshow. They're nothing more than entertainment and charisma. They may make you feel good for the moment, but when you get back in your automobile, they have said absolutely nothing that's going to encourage you to be hungry for God and to grow in the grace and knowledge of Jesus Christ. I love feeling good at church, but I need something more than just making me feeling good at 12 o'clock on Sunday morning. I need something that'll stick with me at 8 o'clock Monday morning when I'm working with God-cussing heathens and you're wrapped up in a world that's trying to pull everything about God out of you. I need more than a performance when I go to church. I need preaching! Now, in case you don't know it, the third category of preacher is the one you're stuck with. And that is a preacher that pushes you. I am a pushy preacher. And what I'm trying to do is push you into a closer relationship with Jesus Christ than you've ever had. There is another level to your Christian life. And I don't want you to be satisfied where you're at. I don't want to be satisfied where I'm at. I always sing that old song, "Lord, plant my feet on higher ground." And so I'm the type of preacher that's going to try to motivate you to get stronger, to be more faithful, to be more dedicated, to witness more, to pray more, to read your Bible more. That's called a pushy preacher. But I'm pushing you in a godly manner, not in something that's going to destroy you. But church people are strange people. They love their comfort zone. And they feel uneasy when God's word is presented in a way that encourages them to make a move. Because they're creatures of habit. And even they'll get to the point where if you push on them so much, they'll just start missing church. And if you keep pushing on them, they'll just quit church. But I can't quit pushing just because you don't like it. There's a church that'll pamper you this way, and there's one that'll perform for you that way. But as long as Phil Kidd's on the pastor sign of this church, when you come, I'm going to preach a message that's going to do everything I can to get you right with God. It's the only kind of preaching I know. And so because of that, people come and people leave. I want to ask you a question as my congregation. When is the last time you have personally made an attempt to be closer to Jesus than what you are? I feel like after reading the Bible, the same restraints that hindered 11 out of 12 disciples from moving and getting closer to God seems to be the same main reasons why people don't get closer to Jesus today. So I want to preach for a few minutes on the subject, why people don't want to get close to Jesus. What is the motive or the reasoning that would hinder us from being closer to Jesus this year than we were the year before? I say to all the people, Brother Carter, that joins our church, I say to them, if you will stay with me a year, you will not be the same person in a year that you are today. How many of you did I say that to when you come here? How many of you that's been true in your life since you've been here? Look at the hands all over the building. Now, it's not because I'm a good preacher. I know better than that. I got a mother-in-law. I know what it's like to be criticized. I know I'm not the best preacher in the world, but I know how to push this Bible on you. I know how to let the Holy Ghost filter your life. And when we get to the point where we don't want to keep growing in the grace of God, then you may not mean to, but the waves of this world will slowly start drifting you away from God. You must remember, Brother Atkins, all the time Peter was going closer to Jesus, the other 11 were getting further away. So when you're under Bible preaching, and I admit it's not much, but it's all I got, this Bible will either catapult you closer to God or the world will make you drift farther away from God. Now, some of you, sad to say, you're stagnant in your Christian life. You're not expounding. You're not growing. You're not producing. Why? Let me show you four things that I believe hindered the Apostle Peter this day, and I'll give you the thoughts that maybe one of these is why you're not getting closer to Jesus. Number one, sometimes when you want to get closer to Jesus, you're going to have to leave your family and friends. You see, Peter was in a boat with 11 other men, but you don't understand unless you really think about it. One of those other 11 men was his brother. It was his brother, Andrew, that led him to Christ. Andrew was his model. Andrew was his influence. Andrew was saved before Peter was. Matter of fact, Peter was Andrew's first convert after he got born again. So Peter is in a boat, and he's got his family there. But he's also got James and John in the boat. They were fishing buddies. They were in the production of catching fish together as a business for many years. So he's got business partners. He's got friends. Matthew was in the boat. That was his CPA and tax collector. All of his closest relationships in this world were in that boat, and they were content to be in the boat. But when Peter decided he was going to get closer to Jesus, do you understand, Brother Lenny, when he took a step out of that boat, he had to turn his back on family, relationships, business opportunities, and the closest friends he had in this world. You know why some of you will never get closer to God than what you are? Because you are more accepted by your friends. You want to be accepted by them more than you want to be accepted and have a relationship with God. You want the approval of those around you more than you want the approval of God. And I'm telling you, there's going to be a time in your Christian life, as you're getting closer to God, you're going to find out there's going to be a point in your spiritual walk where God may demand you to shed some friendships and relationships that you can get closer to Him than you've ever been. And it hurts. It's not easy. But the hurt is soon healed. healed by his presence and power that God will put upon your life. Abraham had to do it. Moses had to do it. Ruth had to do it. David had to do it. Amos had to do it. Ezekiel had to do it. Jeremiah, the Apostle Paul had to do it. They had to turn their back on those they loved the most, but it put them in a level with God that they never dreamed they would ever face. I'm saying, don't even let your closest friend, don't even let your closest relative keep you from being everything God wants you to be, even if you have to do it alone. Get out of the boat and do it. It may be a lonely life, Brother Bledsoe, but it's a blessed life to walk with God. You know, I remember when I first got saved, there wasn't a family in the world, Brother Jim, that was more excited than my family was to hear I became a Christian. I had broke their hearts. I had disgraced my family. I have ruined our reputation in our community. And when I came home November 22nd, 1975, and told them, Brother Guy, that I got born again, there wasn't a happier family in the world to know that I'd become a Christian. But it wasn't long, Brother Gaines, till I got too saved for them. They didn't mind me getting out of the hell holes and the dives and the places of ill repute. But when I started saying I'm going all the way with God and I want God to control my life and I'm not going to certain places and I don't talk like that anymore and I'm not running with that, all of a sudden they started calling me a religious freak. All of a sudden I was a Pharisee. All of a sudden I was a holier than I, a holier than thou. And all of a sudden the same people that was glad I got saved, almost to hear them talk, Brother Atkins, seemed like they'd rather I acted like I was before than I was since I got born again. And Brother Joe, I had to come to a place in my life where whether my mom and dad understood it, whether my brother and sister understood it, whether my neighbors understood it or not, I had one thing in my heart. I want to get close to Jesus. And I got out of the boat by myself. And daddy never clapped and mama never cheered. You do it because it's right, not because it's popular. When my senior prom came up, and we have some of you that will be graduating soon, I was a born-again Christian. I got saved in November, and we were graduating in May. And I decided I wasn't going to the prom because I got saved. And I wasn't going to a dance floor where the lights were turned off and the music was blaring and teenagers were laying drunk and spending the night in the motel with each other. I said, I'm not going there. I'd only been saved a few months, Brother Randy, but I had enough sense to know I wasn't going to get closer to Jesus if I was going to stay in the boat with that crowd. And brother, I had opportunity after opportunity. I was a wrestler through high school, knew a lot of opportunities that I could have went to the prom, no problem there. Look at me, teenage boys. You know what I did on my prom night? I sat in my bedroom by myself with long playing LP albums of the Inspiration Singing Group and listened to them sing gospel songs. And while they were down there dancing and drinking and fornicating and screwing their lives up, I sat by myself in a bedroom and was listening to the Inspiration sing, "Someday we're gonna tour that city." And I'm telling you, the tears, there was nobody in the room but me, and tears running down my eyes. I had more fellowship, I had more of the presence of God, brother, than I'd had in a long time. I said, I'm not going that route. I'm getting out, and I may be by myself, but I decided one thing: I'm going to Jesus, even if I have to go by myself. I'm going to Jesus. And it's not easy because you're tempted to give in. I remember Miss Karen and Brother Ron, and I love them so much. They've been such a great blessing to this church. I remember Miss Karen came and Miss Natisha brought her, and she got saved the first service she ever came. She got born again. Whoop! And she came to me and she said, Brother Kidd, I've got a problem. She said, my husband's not right with God. He's not in church. And she said, he said that he would come with me once in a while if I would just not go to Sunday school and just drop in on church. I said, Miss Karen, how close do you want to get to Jesus? I'm not answering your question by what you should do with your husband. I'm asking you, how close do you want to be to Jesus? She said, I understand. And she started coming to Sunday school by herself. She's sitting right back there. She came by herself. Miss Linda, you can understand what that must be like to get in your automobile and start it up, and your husband's sitting in the living room watching television. And Brother Charles, you got to go by yourself. Miss Katie, you remember coming here by yourself. But see, you do what you're supposed to do, whether you have people applauding you or understanding you or not. You just keep going. A few weeks went by and a man walked by my office that I didn't know. And I jumped up and I went and I looked. I said, who is this? Miss Karen said, that's my husband. This is Ron. He started coming to Sunday school. He came a couple of services, and one Sunday morning, I'll never forget it, he stepped out of the pew and ran to the altar, and he grabbed me around the neck, and he said, preacher, I'm in a mess, and I want a new start with God. And he got right with God right here in front of this pulpit. You see Brother Ron sitting back there? Brother Ron, I want you to stand up. I want everybody to see you, because he's not only a member of our church, he's in charge of our Sunday school department. You know why that happens? Because people do right whether their family understands it or not. You know why Brother Charles is sitting on the third pew of my church weeping this morning with tears running down his face? Because month after month, Miss Katie came by herself and sat there all alone and watched all of you ladies come with your husband and no doubt said within herself, I wonder what it would be like to sit in church with my husband. And she came, and I know there was times she didn't feel like it, and I know there's times you're tempted to give up, but she kept coming and she kept coming. You know who that is sitting there crying on the third row this morning? That's her husband. He got born again here. I'm saying you gotta go on. You gotta go on. And sometimes you've got to leave your family to be everything God wants you to be. Number two, could it be they didn't get out of the boat? If you're going to get closer to Jesus, if you're not getting closer to Jesus, it could be a lack of faith. Now I'm gonna be honest, y'all can jump up and say, bless God, I'd have done it too. Shut up. I'll tell you something. I don't know, Brother Joe, if I'd have got out of that boat or not. You got to understand, Peter had been a fisherman all of his life. Brother Doug, from the time he was born, all he ever knew was his daddy saying this to him. You get out of the boat, you're going to die. You get out of the boat, you're going to drown. You get out of the boat, there's no future. You get out of the boat, it's bigger than you are. You're going under. You're never coming up. You're never going to get rescued. You're going to die. Don't you ever get out of the boat. That's all he had heard all his life. And then all of a sudden, Jesus says, come here. Okay, now what are you going to do? Are you going to do what daddy says? Are you going to go by what you've heard all your life? Or are you going to have enough faith to stay? Now, I'm going to tell you, I don't know what everybody else would have done. I'd have put one foot in first and kept the other one in the boat. You can call it straddling the fence, but at least I was halfway there. That's more than what most of you would have done. But you know why people don't want to get closer to Jesus? Because they don't want God to demand things out of them that's going to increase their faith. See, walking by faith is not really walking by faith until you allow God to take you beyond your limitations and your reasoning. My daddy always taught me, can't, never did anything. You will never know the true potential of your faith until you allow God to totally control your life. And when you take your hands off of it and throw it all on him and say, it's sink or swim with Jesus, that's when God begins to mature and expand your faith in him. And now, Brother James, we're all at different levels here. So if you've been walking on the water for a while, don't turn back and look at the ship to a new convert and criticize them because they're a little hesitant. Maybe they're not as far down the road with God as you are. That's okay. You leave them alone. Keep your mouth shut. They'll mature and they'll come along, Brother Mike, and one day they'll be walking on the water too. But there comes a time and a place when God wants to mature you. And when you let go, that's when God begins to perform the miracle, is when you take your hands off of it. Peter did not have a life jacket on. You understand, he didn't have a whistle he could blow for help. It was just him and God. I'll never forget when the Lord first called me to preach, talking about faith. I remember him developing me. I remember, Brother Mark, the first few times I stepped out of the boat, how hesitant I was. I remember wondering to myself, what if this doesn't, you know, I've always had plan B, and I've always said, okay, what if this doesn't work? And God said, now, as long as you got plan B, nothing's going to work. Because when you're going to come close to me, there is no plan B. Everything is me, and I had trouble with that. And I'll never forget, my wife and I were sitting in a restaurant. I'll never forget this. And I was talking to my aunt and uncle. I just turned 19 years old. God had called me to preach. And I remember I was making big money. I was doing very well financially. And I remember sitting there and I told my uncle, I said, I believe God's wanting me to go to Bible college. I had several problems. I was on probation and they were paying minimum wage down there. And I said, man, I'm married and I'm going to have to live on minimum wage. And I got this good job. And boy, I could just feel God saying, are you going to get out of the boat or not? You going to get out of the boat? And I'm saying, but Lord, I got a good job. Let me go to school here. And the Lord said, I want you to come. And I'm saying, but I'm married. I just got married, man. I'm 19. We're happy. All my life's coming together. I'm in a good church. And the Lord said, yeah, but I want you to come. And I'll never forget it. I looked at my uncle. I'm in a huge restaurant. And I looked at my uncle and I said, Uncle Buford, your faith bothers me. Because you act like if I step out of this boat and never look back, God's just going to send money in from out of nowhere to take care of my family. I no sooner said that. This was the first time I ever really put my feet in the water. When I said that, a woman come up to the table weeping and said, sir, I have no idea who you are. I'm sitting way over there on the other side of the restaurant. That baby in that car seat is mine. And I don't know you from Adam. But just a minute ago when I bowed my head to pray for my food, God told me to come over here and give you $5. Does that mean anything to you? I said, God told you to do what now? She said, God told me to give you five. I said, you sure it was a five? You sure it was a five? And she said, I don't know you. I don't know where you're at in life, but God just told me to tell you, it's okay. He can take care of you. And that was the first time, Brother Guy, I ever put my foot in the water. And now, 39 years later, I've tried to walk with the Lord. I've tried to get closer to God. But I've learned God can take care of you. You say, but I can't figure it out. You don't have to figure it out. He's already got it figured out. You don't figure it out. You faith it out. Get out of the boat. Walk with God. Number three. Could it be that they didn't want to get out of the boat because they didn't want to look on his face? They didn't want to look at Jesus. Now watch this, Brother Bledsoe. You remember when Moses was communicating with God, he took Israel up on the mountain the first time, and God came down with power and lightning in a cloud, and it scared the people of Israel, and they ran back down the mountain and told Moses, said, look, man, we need an intercessor. We don't want to get close that close to God, because when we get that close to him, he's demanding holiness. You remember when Moses saw him in the burning bush, Brother Manus? God said, take your shoes off. You're on holy ground. And Brother Guy, they knew the closer they got to God, the holier he was going to demand their life to be. And could it be that these disciples didn't want to get out of the boat because they knew if they got closer to Jesus, there were some things in their life they were going to have to get rid of? Could it be that it was a lack of wanting to be in his presence to the point where they knew the opportunity to get closer to God would change their lives forever? You remember this same Peter that walked on the water in our text. Watch this. A couple of chapters later, Jesus had been crucified and Peter's fishing. You remember Jesus got up on resurrection and he's standing on the seashore and he said to them, children, have you any meat? And the same apostle Peter that heard his voice before, instead of getting out of the boat and running to Jesus, here's what your Bible said. He jumped in the water. You know why? Because he was naked. He knew he was living in a way that wasn't pleasing to God. Now instead of walking on the water, he's a jumping in the water. Because he knows he's not as close to God as he should be, and he's not as close to God as he once was. And some of you are looking at me pale like you don't understand where I'm going today, but you know exactly where I'm going. The reason why you will not let God get closer to you is because of a habit in your life, a friendship in your life, the music you're listening to, the dress standards of your life, the moral accountability of your life. And brother, most Christian people, I hate to say it, are content where they're at, and it's like Peter when Jesus was being crucified, he followed afar off. I don't want to be like that. If you're happy that way, help yourself. I don't want to be warmed up by the fires of the enemy. I want to get closer to God. I want to be more than I've ever been. I want God to be more in my life. I want him to have control. Because listen, the closer you get to God now, the less regrets you're going to have later on in your life. Number four, and I'm done. I'm going to tell you why some of you don't get closer to God. Because you're afraid that people are going to laugh at you if you fail. Now, this is the only part about the story you know. Peter sank. And that's the only thing you know about the story, is that he sank. Because we love to hear negativity about people. We love it. People can text you or call you on the phone and say something positive, and you'll say, hey, that's great. But they can text you or call you with something negative, and dear Lord, you retweet it or twat it, whatever you call it, and man, it's all over Facebook and Backbook and everywhere else, and boy, you're sending it around the world on media, and you want everybody to know this negative news. That's in our being. We love negativity. It's our personality. It's our depravity, so to speak. And the only thing you know about Peter is he fell. How many of you already knew that Peter sank when he was walking on the water? Raise your hand. Sure, all of you did, because that's all you know about the story. But failure was not final. And by the way, Brother Jim, if I am going to fail, I want to fail trying to get closer to Jesus. He was close enough that God heard his voice over the foamy wave. And when Peter cried, save me, the Bible said immediately, Jesus picked him up again. You know why some of you won't get out of the boat? Because one time you did, and you failed. You quit church. You got in sin. You got to doing stuff you shouldn't have done, going places you shouldn't have gone. And now you say, I failed, I've sunk, I've blown it. Everybody in the boat's laughing at me, so this is all you're getting out of me. Well, let me say, if people really believed that, this world would be in a mess. And let me close by saying this. Thomas Edison, his teacher sent him home when he was a lad of a boy, and this is what the note said to his mother. Your child is stupid. He cannot learn anything. But he patented over 1,000 inventions in his life, and one of them is the light bulb that's hanging over your head. Oprah Winfrey was fired from a television station and says, you have absolutely no ability to be on camera. She owns her own network now, and she's one of the richest women in the United States of America. Walt Disney was fired from his first job working at a newspaper columnist because they said he had lack of ideas and no imagination. And he's turned around and built the number one amusement park in all the world. Mr. Macy was fired from a retail store saying, you don't know how to sell anything. But today, he owns the largest chain of department stores in the world. Harold Sanders was fired from every public job he ever had in his life. So disgusted, he went home and decided to fry some chicken. It's the truth. You can't make this stuff up. And I've stood in the kitchen where he first started. Harold Sanders, fired from every public job he ever had, went home, decided to cook some chicken. Somebody said to him, that's good enough to pay for. Tonight, while I'm preaching, there are 18,000 locations of KFC in the United States of America. Dick Cheney, our vice president for 8 years, not only dropped out of Yale University, but he dropped out of Yale University twice. They said, you're a failure, you'll never amount to anything. And he became the vice president of the United States of America for 8 years. Isaac Newton was pulled out of school by his mother and had to go to a farm and plow the rest of his young life. Later, he came back and designed his own revamping of physics and mathematics that are still used in educated levels of all branches today. Albert Einstein, his teacher told his mother, this man has difficulty communicating, and I doubt that he will ever learn anything in his life. But today, he's respected as the most powerful and influential genius that has ever lived in the world, and before his death, he received a Nobel Prize in physics. Theodore Seuss wrote a book for kids, and they said nobody will read that stupid book called A Cat in a Hat. He was turned down by 27 publishers, but when he took his last breath and died, 600 million copies of The Cat in a Hat was sold. Henry Ford was fired from every job he had. They said he didn't know anything about innovation or looking into the future. And he created the automobile that many of you got here to church today. You know what I'm saying? Failure don't have to be final. Okay, you've made a mistake. You've allowed circumstances or people to get between you and God. All you got to do is cry out to him. He will immediately show up and rescue you. And it all starts with you and I being willing to take one step to get closer to Jesus. Let's stand with our heads bowed and our eyes closed. Behold.